facilities are not provided, those their sickness will continue and ultimately that is the result. Similarly, if somebody is suffering with one leg, then somebody, government has to provide him some support. If support is not provided, ultimately what will happen? And the last thing is, it is the responsibility of the popular government. I am emphasizing this point, it is the responsibility and the prime responsibility of government that they should educate these people. The education should reach to the people, these tribal people. Otherwise, what will happen? They are only thinking what is to be done, what is to be not done. People, pioneers are working, they are just they are giving the rounds, production angle, they don't achieve anything. You teach them how to walk, to know which stream to be entered, where is the life, where you can have the things to be done, which can be useful in the future. These people are not guided, guidance is not given. When there is no education, the rest of the things does not reach to their level.
Thank you, Mr. Gao.
Can I now request, Advocate Shanti Fonseca, she's a lawyer, writer, social activist, to talk on human rights and labor.
What I will be speaking to you this morning is not because I'm some authority on labor law, I'm certainly not, but it is from experience of some of my cases which I have been fighting in court. Again, I would like to clarify, I'm not a very frequent visitor in the industrial tribunal, but I have been handling a lot of cases in the civil courts related to labor. So I would be giving you more of examples and less of any, I mean, my explanation would be through my cases. I think I would first like to start by saying that human rights is not something which somebody gives you as a gift. It's not like your government is giving you something by virtue of enacting some law or giving you some protection. It is something which right from the, it's not from the time you're born, but like Father Mervick said, it is from womb to tomb that we should be protected, and it is our right, inherent right. So it is not given from somebody. It is unfortunate that because of violations being so much, the whole question of human rights comes in, or even law steps in, only when violations, I mean, you're drowning in them, and then law steps in to correct something which we have to. For example, you would not have a Water Pollution Act 100 years ago, or you would not have a smoking, anti-smoking something 50 years ago, or you would not have domestic violence 200 years ago. When you look at every law, law is nothing but a reflection of the society we live in. And the more laws you have, it's only telling you that you are living in conditions where we are more and more inhuman. Once upon a time, we used to say dog eat dog world, or used to read that in the paper. Today I would say it is a man eat man world. And we are really in that situation where nobody is thinking twice. There is something in Konkani, a nice word, what we call munshepon. That munshepon has disappeared from everybody and we have become totally inhuman. Whatever everybody else is going to talk, it's only because this one word has been removed from our bodies, from our souls, from our minds, from everything. I think I will come straight to some of the... Now, I have taken most of my cases from the government department because government is supposed to be the model employer. And if government behaves in this way, then you can multiply it by 100 what is happening in the private companies outside. For example, in the postal department, you have 30 workers in Goa, and they're all Goans. Okay, they're doing all this loading work, sorting work, and now loading work sometimes can be very heavy because the parcels are not all small parcels. They are heavy machinery and things like that sometimes. They're doing all this kind of work, and besides that, all other kind of miscellaneous work is given to them also. Their salaries till 2 years back was 20 rupees a day. These 30 workers were being paid 20 rupees a day, and it is only now in the last 3 months that it has increased by 7 rupees, that is 27 rupees. Now, these are all Goans, not non-Goans. Justice Verma will be familiar with, that there is a law which says, that is the under the contract, this thing, that when work is perennial nature, it is every day, and people are working for years, such workers should be regularized. But this has not happened. And even now, they are paid only 27 rupees. Now, these are central government employees, obviously, because postal government comes under the central. So after much battling in the court, what we have managed to get is only 7 rupees extra in the... And added to that is that continuously there have been new recruitments being done. It's not that that there are no new recruitments over these years. So many new recruitments, but these people are not being absorbed. So this is your postal department, which is central employee, central government. Coming to BSNL, right now you have something like 450 contract workers. Again, all are Goans. These are not non-Goans. These are all Goans, and most of them are working for more than 15 years. Some of them even 25 years. The nature of work is all your digging, excavation, putting the wires, and you're repairing your telephones or installation of telephones. Now, this is all perennial work, and this is something which will always be there. Now, none of these people have been regularized. They are there. Now, for years together, there was no, though some of them are 20 years, some are on the verge of retirement, there was no Provident Fund, ESI, gratuity, no benefits to them at all. So, we had put a case in the court for these workers specifically for benefits. After a long battle, for these 350 workers, what we got was 1 crore and 16 lakhs in favor of the workmen, which was granted towards their Provident Fund. But right now, BSNL has gone in appeal against this. And now to the tribunal in Delhi, it's an appeal at the tribunal in Delhi. Now, meanwhile, workers continue to work under contract at less than minimum wages. This is again a point to be noted, because there is something called minimum wages. As per central government directives, it is around 225, that is those who are working in the central government, for unskilled workers. Well, as in Goa, they are being paid only 150. Now, this is a government body, and even their own minimum wages, they are not following, which is the daily wages. Goa is the most expensive place to live in India, that all of us know. So you can just imagine some of them, what are their conditions. The present BSNL contractor is now paying them 100. Now, after going to court, he's paying them 135. So he has decreased. After taking him to court, he has decreased. And more shocking is that he is not a licensed contractor. This is the BSNL contractor who's employing under contract labor, and he is not a licensed contractor. We know that under Section 10 of the Contract Labor Act, that if any contractor is not properly having a valid license, then automatically the workers are supposed to be taken in as permanent workers, just like the other workers. There is a clause. No such thing has ever happened, and he's happily going on taking more and more workers. So workers who question, or who unionize, or who he just asked them to leave, or bring in new workers. So getting them together also is very difficult. Now, again, coming to this thing of contract, people who are working in contract, one of the very big violations which is being done is, I think in more than 50% of the cases or more, whatever they are being paid, even when we are saying 135 or 125 or whatever, sometimes they get only 60 or 70 rupees, and they have to either put their thumb impression or signatures, and most of it goes to the contractor. So this also we should know, that even that little bit they don't really get. Another case, again coming to government, this thing is your Goa Medical College. Just now we have about again 350 workers over, who are the ones who clean the toilets, do the sweeping, swabbing, the ones at the lower level. Now again, most of them have above 25 years of service, and some of them on the point of retirement. Again, it is all daily wage, and the same thing where the minimum wages are not being paid. You have the PWD society, that is your public works department. Now they have over 2,000 contract workers. PWD has over 2,000. Now all this when the government is supposed to be your model employer. I just made some points for this thing is like, I remember in some of the cases where in villages, in hotels, the retrenchment is done very, 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 very easily. Because there is a reason why. which I discovered through cases which I had been fighting in court. First and foremost, what the employer does when he wants to retrench, you know, full groups of people, he gets an injunction from the court to say that within 500 meters, you know, people cannot come, or depending, sometimes he gets a bigger area also. So workers cannot come within 500, the same workers whom he wants to retrench. This is a standard thing which is done, especially in hotels. In hotels, it is perennial. Every year when they want to change the employees who are there, who are not permanent, like your room boys and your maintenance boys and things like that, they get this order from the court to say, they'll give specific names that these people cannot come within this area. And it is very unfortunate that is why I said civil court, because all these matters come to the civil court, that there is a little more understanding when you reach the high court. But then these matters come either before the district court or before the senior division judge. And in most of the cases, they are very insensitive. Either they are ignorant about what is happening, or they are really not bothered. And then it's a lot of effort to go in appeal to the high court, because in the meantime, a lot of damage is done to the workers. And why is it that the hotels don't bother about this retrenchment is because they have their substitutes very easily available. You have a lot of these catering colleges and these all these other institutes, like, you know, people who are doing MBA and this, that and the other. So the minute they want to retrench these people, then happily all the students from the catering college and all are called to fill in. So sometimes you'll have someone telling you, you know, my son, he's working for 3 months in the Taj Hotel, or you cannot tell them that he's actually working in place of people who should be permanently employed or whatever. You know, so they put us against each other. So this is a very normal thing which happens in the hotel industry, that all your people from the catering colleges are used royally for free service and like a kind of apprenticeship. So on this thing of apprenticeship and training, I think a lot of study needs to be done, because most of the time it's exploitation and stamping on the feet of the workers. The other thing which I found very funny going to courts is that when very often they want to say the leader of the, who's there of the workers, they want to get him in trouble, they'll put a theft case against him or some sexual harassment or something like that. Most often it is theft. Now sometimes it's just a screwdriver or a spanner or something like that. And when you go for the bail, because you have to, it's a process, you have to go for the bail. Sometimes the judge will say 20,000 or 10,000, and I find it so ridiculous, because in cases of gang rape and rape and murder, you're getting 10,000. I mean, I have so many cases where, and in these small things where the person, and then they'll ask for, you know, personal surety, I mean, extra surety plus some local person from the village, and in cases of if they are not Goans, it becomes very difficult to get them the bail, because they'll ask for 2-3 other, and this is purely a violation of human rights. I mean, it's somebody who's lived 30 years, 40 years in Goa, and then you say, no, let him get some local person, or let him, the amounts, what I'm saying is, I find it very funny about the amounts. Imagine 20,000 or 10,000 for a spanner or a screwdriver which is gone, when in case of gang rape, you're paying 10,000 for the bail. So this bail amount is one of this thing. Another point which I have noted is with the call centers. We are having a lot of call centers which are opening up in Goa and or have already opened up. And besides our boys, young boys, young men, and the male people who are going there, you have a lot of young girls who are going to the call center. Actually, my concern is more for the girls than the boys. It is for all who are working. But there is a lot of exploitation and of these girls. And one of the things which I have seen because of 2-3 cases which came to me is many of these girls suffer from urinary infection, because the toilets are not enough. And it's not just a simple urinary infection. Over a period of time, it gets quite serious. And then, you know, they're not able to talk to their mothers or to somebody. So, you know, it comes through an outside sort of this thing, because they feel bad or embarrassed or whatever. But this is one problem which our girls are facing in the call centers. So I thought I would just, other than, you know, besides the working hours and things like that. Now, I think the last issue I will touch on is a favorite this thing where many of us did have a fight, and that was the meta strips. Now, Metastrips just now is in the process of heavy retrenchment. Metastrips is one of the big things which Goans fought for not to have it here. And they have acquired huge lands. What I have been given to understand very recently is that they are going into very heavy retrenchment. Again, these are all Goan boys, and they are going to go into real estate with the land which they have taken. Now, coming back again to when these people get these injunctions in these for all these factories and these companies, a very standard thing is done after the injunction is that in the night all the machinery is removed, taken to another place. And again, they will avail of all the subsidies, this, that, and the other, in the other place. And this is a continuing process. So the same thing with, so you keep workers away after getting the injunction. And of course, police are always with the management, or if you want to say they are doing their duty, so they will give the protection. And most of the time, overnight, all, so there is hardly anything which the workers have to hold on to once all the machinery is gone. So coming to the issue of workers' rights or the issue of labor, that we are living in a very difficult situation, and whether it be the environment or whether it be rights of children or whether it be the rights of women or rights of tribal or all the rights you can think of, indirectly and directly all these rights are related to workers. And most of the issues we talk about, whether it is polluted air or polluted water, like somebody said the other day, if only we could drink get pure water to drink. It is so funny that everywhere we go, we have to either have it from the bottled water or we are having it at home from AquaGuard. I mean, for us it was open the tap and drink water. So at one side we are saying so much of development, the other side is we do not have proper drinking water to drink. So it is all these kind of things where this would be a topic for, but everything is related to globalization. At the end of the day, whatever issues we are facing, whatever threats we are facing, whatever oppression we are facing, whatever disasters and everything else you would like to say. Another point is what Satish just pointed out today's paper, that somebody has died. Well, it's not somebody today because it's come in the paper. Every day there are people who are dying in factories. And most of the time, whether it's a construction site, whether it is in these, you have a lot of chemical industries in Goa, you have a lot of chemical industries. You have in Kunkoli, Kankon, Tue, Pedne, Sankwal, and many more places where very often you have workers who fall because there are no, they have those gates which are put before the molten, whatever that thing which melts. Every month there are X number of people who die in these chemical factories. There's no record of it because very often we do not know how many people are inside. So there is no identification and the body is just kind of, so it is on construction sites also, at least once in 15 days we will read that some laborer has fallen and died. But it's not a question of once in 15 days, it is every day laborers are falling and dying. But there is no value which is put to their life and their bodies are just disposed of without anybody knowing at all. So you have this kind of, another thing which is common is in the trawlers and the in the fishing boats. So many times you have fishing boats which are capsizing, the trawlers which go into the sea. There is no account of who they are taking on the boat. And if there are accidents, there is no accountability of these people's lives. So one can go on and on into violations. But at the end of the day, we need to tackle the whole thing because globalization is very much related to much of the problems we are having. And we need to talk about that maybe later. So this is what I would say in my short presentation on the workers' rights.
Can I invite Dr. Nishtha Desai, Director of Children's Rights in Goa, now to talk on child rights in Goa.
Justice Verma, Mr. Ranade, and friends, the brief presentation I'm going to make today is pertaining to the rights of children. And one of the assumptions that I'm operating on, this is an audit, so looking at it in terms of an audit, I want to first of all say that the presumption is that there is prevalence of child abuse, there is prevalence of child labor. We don't have aggregate, you know, we don't have statistics and data which accurately reflect how many child laborers there are or how many children are into sexual services, how many children are being commercially sexually exploited. We don't have these figures. But what I thought we could focus on is what are the mechanisms that we have in place and what is it that we need to have. So if we look at what we have in Goa, we have a plethora of acts. We have the central acts which prevail, fully effective, but they are there. Is the children's court. We have district inspection teams. We are meant to have special officers who are appointed to implement the act. And there are a few villages which have village child committees. So we have acknowledgement that there is child labor. Even statistics, government statistics, put child labor at above 4,000 child laborers in Goa, which actually means that it will be much more than that. When we go to the police with complaints of tourism-related child sexual abuse, before there was a time when we'd be told that this is something in your minds, it can't exist. Now they do register cases. Trafficking, we regularly hear reports, and there was an anti-trafficking cell also that was constituted. And we have inclusive education. Under the Goa Children's Act, we are meant to have a plan of action which... Now, the Goa Children's Act, by the way, was enacted in 2003. This year, it is the 8th anniversary of the Act. According to the Act, when it was enacted, that in 7 years... Some disturbance. I think one mic is on. One of the things under the Act was that there was a commitment made that in 7 years from the commencement of the Act, universal elementary education and eradicate of child illiteracy would be achieved. Today, now it is 8 years. I mean, on 8th of July, it will be 8 years since the enactment of this Act. And we have not achieved universal elementary education. In fact, now we have again the RTE, which everyone is talking about. But already we had in place the Goa Children's Act, and we need the plan of action to be notified. We need it to be made into something, a real plan of action to be formulated. We also have a plan of action that was supposed to be formulated for the prevention and early detection of differently abled children and to ensure inclusive education. So this also is a plan of action. To some extent, we do have some amount of inclusive education. We have resource centers in a number of schools, but it is still nowhere near. You still find many children who are excluded from the education process. There are many children who need to be brought into the fold and who need to be part of inclusive education. The state was to formulate a comprehensive plan of action to eradicate all forms of child labor in a phased manner. And this plan of action is supposed to be published in the Official Gazette every year. There was also to be a plan of action to stop trafficking. And this also included ensuring that children who are rescued from trafficking are given livelihood skills. You find a number of children, you know, who you find are out of school. So this is a case where we found one child who was being constantly taunted by other children who used to call him a thief. We have child activity centers, so these children were coming to our child activity center. Then what emerged was, and this is a Goan child. This is, you know, we tend to think that only the children of the migrant community suffer from various problems and belong to the socially, economically deprived classes, but even there are Goan children. And... this child was being taunted and being told that he's a thief. But then it emerged that this child was the main breadwinner of the family. And if he didn't go out to work, if he didn't sell his potis and make enough, then he was forced to take fish from the fisherwomen. He was forced to, you know, steal fish from the fisherwomen and sell it. And he was supporting his sick mother, his alcoholic father, and a young sibling. So then on seeing that this was happening, we convinced the mother to stay in a home with a younger sibling. And the child was produced before the Child Welfare Committee and was sent to a boarding school. Initially, the child found it very difficult to cope and ran away. But later on, again, the child was brought and he stayed in the boarding home. Today, he's very happy and he's doing quite well. This is 4 years hence. Now, we need the government to have places where this kind of rehabilitation can take place. And you find that many of the NGOs who are working in the field have lots of cases like this. But each time we have to struggle to formulate a rehabilitation plan because of lack of rehabilitation existing. So what do we need to do? We need to realize that child rights is everybody's concern. We need to create awareness about the laws, especially amongst the vulnerable sections, especially about what their rights are. Then under the Goa Children's Act, we need to publicize provisions of the Act, make the action plans a reality. We have special officers appointed under the Act, but they are Mamlatdars. And we know how heavily burdened Mamlatdars are. So it cannot happen that they are going to implement the Act. We need to have special officers who are appointed who will actually be able to implement this Act. Then the police department is to formulate a child code and make police stations child friendly. We know today how people unfriendly police stations are and how most people land up not registering complaints when they go there. The tourism department is to formulate a child-friendly tourism code, which would then lead to it monitoring, its regulating its own industry and ensuring that there are good practices followed in the tourism industry. But you find that this also, it has been adopted by the Travel and Tourism Association of Goa, but it needs to be adopted by the Government Department of Tourism. We have mechanisms under the JJ Act, the Child Welfare Committee and the Juvenile Justice Board, but none of the mechanisms for non-institutional care are being given the attention that they require to be given. The foster care scheme, sponsorship, where families need not be separated, where children can get sponsorship for their further studies, these things need to be given attention. There is a need for the corporate social responsibility to play a role in vocational training and job placements. And there's a need to strengthen whatever bodies do exist. And most important, we need to stand as a community to ensure that these laws are implemented and to protect children and prevent any form of child abuse. This is just a poster that has been brought out by the Sri Lanka government, which is very colorful and attractive and gives various messages. The government also has budgets for this IEC material and things like that. So we need to have more of this. NGOs are doing this, but this is also the role of the government. So with that, thank you.
Zarina Dakuna, to talk on human rights and quality of life in rural Goa.
A very good morning to you, and my apologies for arriving late. I just had another function in Margao. Human rights and quality of life in rural Goa. Goa is very dear to us, and we all know, with due respects to you, sir, Goa is and always has been a rich and verdant emerald on the west coast, in the Western Ghats. And today, we have all gathered here to comprehend the saga of degradation and devastation in all its hues and colors. Natural, human, environmental, and all this. It's not a rosy picture, really. And hence, a human rights violation case. In this era of virtualism, reality has retreated. Virtues have vanished, and principles have perished. And the lawmakers and keepers have become laggards at their job. Hence, a case for human rights denied. My time will only enable me to throw a flashlight on most of the issues faced in the rural state of Goa. The rural-urban divide and abysmal quality of life to the population that bears the brunt of the urban so-called business brats. In one word, mining companies. They are the cause and effect of our total devastation. The human resource is completely shredded. These are the convicts that connive with the present-day government to reap riches overnight. Hence, an all-out 24/7 effort and results in trampling of rural life that is burnt before its blossoming time. The environmental destruction, this affects the rural Goa very badly. Being an activist, I have gone in the interiors and interacted with people and seen this scene so pathetic. It becomes difficult to formulate in a decent language and with a, you know, a low voice modulation and all that. It fills me with fire sometimes. How much do we talk? How much do we propose? And why is it always that we only meet and conclude something only for a statistical figure? I want to take this opportunity today, before I give you the facts, sir, that we need to have some action orientation and accountability of those that are responsible for this state of affairs. Human rights never was spoken about so much in Goa before, but in this decade, it has become a crying need to uphold human rights in various ways. I will concentrate on this. The nature, our nature, the environment, the forest, pollution of air, disappearing fields, water bodies, dismal health scenario, psychological disorders, social fabric is damaged. All this happens, and the brunt is borne by the rural Goa more. In particular, when all this happens, the population that's in the backyard bears the brunt of it. And there's nobody to voice, and even if they as much as dare to voice that they are surviving somewhere in the rural areas, they are snuffed out. They are intimidated first by the police. The mining mafia effectively pulls the remote controls. They are never there for them, whether they are beaten, if they as much as dare to ask for their rights that are guaranteed in the Constitution. Now, that is a human right violation. A right to clean air, to clean water, a right to live peacefully in their own environment. They are just come. I'm concentrating more on mining because that is where this whole thing percolates to breakdown in, and the quality of life suffers. The environment is polluted, the water is polluted, the fields are gone with sedimentation, with siltation, the water bodies are gone. The forests on which the forest dwellers and tribals depend on, those are vanished. And here we make big talks about conservation, nature, environment. It's not happening. And those that are living in that environment, the rural population that is, really suffers very badly. So then comes the health scenario. The mining dust that enters, that pollutes the air, that directly gets into the people who live there. Their respiratory system is already in shambles, renal problems, because they are constantly working in dust and heat, so renal disorders. I've got some pictures here, which I will be happy to pass around, but I'll just show it to you. How people in the rural area, you won't believe this is a picture taken in Goa, but these are our roads, and these are women who take the broom and sweep off the dust off the street. This is how in rural areas where mining is taking place, people are made to work. Is this a decent human condition? Goa means it's all glitz and glamour and a good time and a free-for-all kind of a thing. Everybody wants a slice of Goa. I don't think anybody would like to. So this is a highway. This is a road that was built to carry a bus, 50 bus trips from rural area to town or wherever for their conveyance. But this road is packed with 5,000 plus mining trucks in a given day. Even if somebody is sick, it is impossible for a ambulance to reach that place. If there's a fire, the fire tender can burn somewhere else because by the time they make it to the spot, it's ages. And the water that these people drink, the foliage is heavily filled with the dust, so the trees die slowly. These are the mining dumps so close at the water source. This is the river. This is at Sakode. I can give you all many examples. I've got vast data, all got under RTI and our pictures which we have taken for facts, which I will submit because today, unfortunately, my electronic system has crashed, so I'm not able to use the effectively for everybody to see. But I'll address the chair rather, because most of us are a little bit aware of this, but the details are here, statistically, figuratively, and picture form. And this is how this open cast mining, nowhere in the world it is done, but all these trucks, they come, they rush, and human beings are like maggots for them. There is no feeling. Influx of migrants, they bring disease, sickness, the health measures are defunct, non-existent. What has increased in a developed economy, in a developed state like Goa, which everybody says is very well developed, I'm very sorry to say there are not even two or three health centers in a radius of 30, 40 kilometers for these tribals and the rural dwellers to come to. This way, the water source is destroyed. This is chemically treated, washed iron ore, which goes into our rivers and comes into our system. Manganese and ferrous particles are already in our water systems, which are 17 times more than normal on any given day. But nobody will give you the yes for it, because you overlook it, and the government will always study the reports. I don't know when they will implement and take cognizance of the fact. This is how the countryside is devastated. All this is happening in the forest region. 70% of mining in Goa happens in the forested region. And this deprives us of our right to live. It destroys the biodiversity, the ecosystems. And we, time and again, every quarterly, I think we come here at NIO and all to save the Western Ghats and all. Western Ghats are destroyed. We have a dam that supplies water to people. That dam was not meant for water supply to people to drink. It was meant for the agriculture of the farmer, the rural people. The whole villages that got displaced were not even till today are not rehabilitated properly. They don't have their basic systems. And we say, like, now that is a case of human rights for me. And the rural suffering is this, and mostly they are farmers, they are tribals and forest dwellers and other economically backward communities. And how are we to get them in the mainstream and say we are giving them better quality of life, better social systems, better hygiene, better health? The only thing that has increased in rural Goa are the number of bars selling adulterated liquor. With that comes other vices, the gutka, the tobacco thing, then these drivers who live there, they bring in other diseases also, chikungunya.